Okay, so this time I wanted to make a clone for the Asteris game, and we'll make it in Rust, just because I wanted to try out the baby game engine more. So to init the project, we can run cargo init, and yeah, now we have some basic files, so we can also cargo run, and yeah, this would give us the hello world that we start with. And yeah, now we can add a baby dependency. So I would use like the latest one, which is 12.1. And yeah, now we can do run again just to get the completion done, like all the packages, all the crates. And I mean, while it compiles, we can also start with the main code, let's say. So we're gonna use a baby prelude like this. So basically, baby is like a game engine. It doesn't have a UI, so you do everything from code. But what is pretty nice about it is that it has an entity component system approach to the game development, basically. And how you create these entities and components and systems is pretty simple in Rust because you use structures and functions. You don't have to implement any classes or anything complicated, so it's just structures and functions like we did for C until now. So yeah, this is how you make the basic window in Baby. So if we run this, we should get like a window. It's completely empty, but it's just, I mean, it's really easy to get started with Baby, I think, even though you don't have a UI to like easily edit position of objects and such, but it's still good. So another thing that might be a bit bad by using Baby is that it compiles slow because of Rust, but I mean it's fine. So yeah, pretty much we already have like an example. But as I said, let's try to make our own small game. So first I would make the window smaller, like let's call it window width and window height. So you can actually modify this default plugin. Let's check maybe default plugin window. We have this window plugin which we can change. So we can say dot set window plugin, and for this one we can say the wait, now we can see here for window plugin we have a primary window, so primary window is sum. Window, and here we can use default for the rest of them. Okay. Here, yeah, we can use these things. We don't have a width and a height. We have position, so no, size, I think. Well, what was it for window? Should be like resolution. Resolution is window width, window height, and we need to use into to convert this tuple to convert this tuple to like a structure that they use. So now we should have a smaller window. Probably it will place it in the center of the screen, but let's see again. Let's also add resizable false. Maybe that. Maybe it's like just because of this window manager that I'm using, it needs that. Okay, so this creates the window. Okay. Now, let's have like the player, right? Like it will be for this demo, it will be like a rectangle in the middle of the screen that you can just rotate with the mouse, and that's everything it does. So player width, player height. I would make it to be fair a bit taller than how wide it is, so that you know what's which part is the front, maybe, I guess. But I mean, you know that by where you point the mouse, so it's not really that important. So now to create like the player, we might need this structure to indicate it's a player. And let's derive component for it. Okay. So now let's have a setup. And in this setup, we will need to create a 2D camera that will display the scene. Camera 2D. I guess we can say here default. That's all we need for the camera. Then to spawn the player, we need this thing like a sprite bundle, but I don't think. So for a sprite. Well, I think we need here more arguments to like generate a sprite. Might need the materials, which is well, actually maybe not. And we just need here like a color. And my guess is that any color would work, so we can just use some random stuff. And as I said, we place this rectangle in the center. And for the other stuff, we can leave them as they are, like default. So that's that. Okay, so here we don't need into. Okay, so maybe we can say sprite. We can give it a size. Here it should be custom size, right? And this says it's an option. Okay. Well, I mean, it's in, I mean an option, so we put some, right? Okay, and for the color, we can have like make it blue, whatever. So here we can insert or add systems for the startup, and we can say setup. So basically now we should see a blue rectangle in the center of the screen. Okay, like this. Maybe we can make it smaller. So like 25 and 50. Still taller than how wide it is. Next to like move it, we will need to insert the player component. And yeah, basically now we when we do some queries in the other systems, we can say that we want the transform components that contain player, so we get the player, right? So let's make this this system for the player movement, but it will be like player rotation more or less. And what do we need here? As I said, it will be the mutable transform query. So I make a query for the transform that contains a player. Okay, we will also need the mouse position. So let's quickly check maybe mouse position. How to get this value. Probably somewhere here. I mean, I really cannot see it in this one, but I'm pretty sure I've seen it here before. I don't think it's mouse motion. I would like to have like the entire position. Well, here it's oh, and do something like this and then get a position from the window. Interesting. So yeah, let's add here window query, and they say to use it like this. Well, I mean it makes sense, sure. I was thinking that it's not really, but yeah, pretty much like this, so that we get the position window query. And okay, let's import that window primary window. Okay, and the idea is that this cursor position returns none if your cursor is outside of the window. So that works for me because we are doing this check here. So if we are outside of the window, then we don't enter this if statement. So yeah, now Let's see. So we might want to iterate all the transforms that we got here. It will only be one, but yeah, I mean, it's a pretty good way to do it. And we need to set the rotation, and we'll use this from rotation Z, right? And probably what you think here, I mean, let's make like a drawing of how we get that angle, right? Let's think. Let's make a new thing here. And yeah, let's say that this is the entire screen. Too small for me. And let's say this is the player. Like this is, well, I mean, I don't have a drawing thing, so it will look how it will look anyway. So let's say the mouse, the pointer is somewhere here, and this is our origin. Like this is the O, like the X-axis, this is the Y-axis, right? And the thing is that our origin of the objects and everything is here, but for the cursor is in the top left corner. So first we have to move this point from this coordinate system to ours. So we need to do what, like subtract half the width and half the height, right? We need to do that first to get it into our coordinate system. And then we have these points, like this is the X coordinate, this is the Y coordinate, and our player is pointing in this direction, and we want it to go into this direction like this. So we need this angle right here, and we get that angle. So this is Y, this is X. We get this angle if we do Y divided by X. Well, no, it's X divided by Y, right? Like this line has length X, this line has length Y. So if you want to get this angle, the tangent of that angle is X divided by Y. And to get like the value of the angle, we can use the, I don't know, it's a tan 2 or something, that function. It does exactly the tan minus 1 of X divided by Y, and we get this angle that we want to rotate with. So first, as I said, let X equals position minus width, and Y will be like this. Okay, and to get the rotation, we basically have to say that X divided by Y, I would say. I was just looking because I don't understand why they do plus pi, but maybe we'll figure out. Who knows? X divided by Y, a tan. I mean, you can also do that, or you can do a tan to Y. Oh, I think I know. But I mean, first let's see what happens if we do add systems. What's it like? Update, play rotation. So now this rectangle should rotate follow the mouse, like this, which is really cool. And if we go outside and then go back in, it snaps to that position. So it works. It's fine for now. Now let's try to add the asteroids. So it will be asteroid radius. We'll have like let's say this is the smallest radius, and we have some levels to it, like level 3, 2, 1, and if it's 3, is 3 times as big or something. Or like the smallest radius and the maximum one. I'm not sure. Let's make the game simple at first. Let's have like if we destroy it, then it's destroyed or something. Let's change the game a bit, sort of say. So derive component. Let's have an asteroid, whatever, and I would spawn them like in update. Maybe we have a timer for it. Const spawn rate, and this should be like in seconds. Let's say, I mean, it feels too fast, 0.5. Let's make it 1 second. Okay. Function asteroid spawn. So yeah, we need the commands, the time. Okay, the and we'll also need here like another component for well, not really a component, could be a resource for our spawn rate. So resources, different components, you have only one of them. So that's the difference between components and resources. And yeah, I would use a resource like for this timer or for images and stuff. So here we have spawn timer. It will be a timer. And let's derive, oh, or it's implement default from I mean, usually I like it more if it's like a structure and not that weird thing. But yeah, you know, it is what it is. So here we create a timer from seconds, and this should be timer mode once. We want it to basically, when we tick the timer, we want it to go to from 0 to spawn rate, but then stop and wait for us to restart it. That's what I'm thinking. So now we can insert resource spawn timer. Or is it? Is it like this? when we do. But I thought that insert resource works something like this, but I'm not sure. Or is it init resource? Yeah, I swear I. It should be like this. Oh, it's. Yeah, the fish operator. Anyway. So, yeah, basically we init this resource. So it will start with the spawn rate set. So it will spawn one asteroid in 1 second. I mean, when we create the thing. So we have the resource, we need a time resource, and we also need our spawn timer, which will be mute, and we need this thing. Okay, and basically, yeah, as I said, we have to tick the timer. And if the timer finishes, well, one thing is to reset the timer and make it go again. So this thing takes a duration, so we might say here into. I don't remember how to do this specifically. We might have like to import use STT time duration and then say duration from 6F32, something like this. So yeah, now I was thinking maybe sprite circle, or I know there is a shape demo for, yeah, and here is a circle, so maybe this is how you spawn a circle, but we also need. Okay, how about we take this into setup? So we put this here, meshes and materials, and we take this here, we create a circle. We don't care about that. Create a circle mesh, and the material, and I mean whatever color, we don't really care about the color, but we want to create these assets basically, like a circle, like a purple circle, or I mean a circle and this material. Though, I mean, for material we can also use the default one, which is white, so it doesn't really matter, but whatever. Let's just keep it. Yeah, although I'm not sure how we can reference the mesh when we create the circle. And that would be interesting to see, because I think that always creating the mesh there would be useless. So let's put these on separate lines. And let's say that we want the meshes, but we need it. We don't want it mutable, we just want the meshes resource. So yeah, like let circle, should it be like this? I mean, it's a bit maybe meshes resource, maybe there is some dock on this thing. Well, I guess one way, like another way to do it, is to have our own, to have our own thing right there. So let's say we take this here and we spawn it. Well, it's material mesh bundle, I guess. And we need a handle to a mesh. And for the material, it's the same thing. Okay, I was just curious if we do add, this returns a handle. Yeah, so I mean, let's have our own resource for the asteroid, like structure, asteroid. Assets, and let's say we have a handle to a mesh and a handle to material. Although I don't know, for the material maybe we can do random colors or something. So let's keep just the mesh. I mean, whatever, let's keep them both. So here in setup, instead of having where was set up here. Instead of having this thing. Oh, I mean, let's also make it have default, I think should work. And let's init resource the assets. And here, let's have this thing. And instead of doing this, well, we might still need those things, right? Because I said we need the handle to. To the asset, because I think new returns just a shape. Okay, anyway, so let's say let mesh equals let material equals, and now we can say, well, I mean, why not just say asteroids assets dot mesh and dot material like that, and now we can use the assets here, and we would say like this, and I mean I see that it still clones it, so I guess that tangent was not really useful. Oh, okay, fine. Let's use the method that they used in the demo. So anyway, let's just create a new thing every time. So copy this. And let's put it in the code. Although, yeah, that should be different. And here is asteroids radius. Or whatever. Yeah, what I'm not sure is if this thing is something, yeah, it's something from okay. So this should spawn. Okay, there is one error or something. Okay, here. Didn't delete everything, but I didn't call the function. Okay, I forgot to call the function. The asteroid spawn that function. So that one, let's call it here with the update. So this should spawn every second one thing here. Okay. So basically that's something. And we need to insert the asteroid here. So next would be to have a random position instead of this. But for that, as you might already know, Rust doesn't have random in its standard library, so we need to use a crate. This is the version. This is pretty weird though. Yeah, I mean it's because random is not safe if you can think about it. So Yeah, let's have a helper function run the position on edge. I mean, on edge sort of say, but we need a victory. Like we are gonna use const window. I mean, is it a margin? Let's say 50. And let's do it like this. So basically, we want to create a number between 0 and 50, or 50 and 600 for the height. And the same thing for the like 550. And yeah. So how can we do that in a nice way? Yeah, I mean, we should map 0 to 1 to that range, but let's see. So let we need this thing, I guess. Then we want an X. But I was thinking to have like a number between 0 and 1 and then use it to map this to something like, if it's below 0.5, then do it between 0 and 50. So let map x equals, and now if x is less than 0.5, then we do x times 2, right? So it's x times 2.02, make it between 0 and 1. And we should multiply it by window margin for the lower edge. And if it's so, this will make it between 0 and 50, let's say. And if it's above, if it's above the, if it's above 0.5, then again make it between 0 and 1. Then multiply by margin, but add but we also need to add window width and subtract one margin from it. Yeah, but it's not even correct because Well, it is because we can subtract half the width then afterwards. So minus window margin, and we need to subtract window width from everything. So yeah, basically that will. So let's say for the exposition. Yeah, so it will give it here or here, right? In this, I don't know if it. I guess it could be like another way to do it, but I have no idea. Cannot think about it right now. So Y is the same thing, but for height instead of width. And yeah, now let's just return the position. And here we return it. So let's see. Okay, I mean, I want to see something like, oh, yeah, that actually is because it has the intersection, right? Like it chooses a number. Actually, it's more like it chooses a number between here and here for this one as well. And after we do the constraint for height, it chooses a number between here and here. So it actually spawns it only in the corners. But for now, let's leave it in the corners, I guess. Let's random position corner. Okay. Let's also add a component for the velocity. Derive component. Velocity. And I mean, this should be a vec. So although, why not just make all of them go towards the player, right? And have just as this guy said, speed. So let's have asteroid mean speed and the max speed. Okay, let's have a function for random speed. Asteroid speed. Just because, whatever, have it here. Not deal with it in the spawn. So here we want to insert the velocity with the random speed. And now we have to actually implement the asteroid movement. So let's make asteroid movement. We'll need the time for the delta time to make it like frame independent. We need the. It's interesting because we can do it like. We can do it like this, so it's like straight query. Yeah, we need a reference. So we need this, and we also need the position of the player. But it's 0-0, so we don't really need it. Okay. Let's see. We need to iterate all of these guys. We have the transform, the velocity, and we want to translate from the current position towards the center. So let's get the direction first. Direction is in fact just the position. We can normalize it, but we need to multiply it with -1, right? Like this is the direction that we need. Transform. Translation. Yeah, I don't know what hell. -1.0. So like if we have a point, let's say somewhere here, this is its position, so this is like the like a vector for it. And if we multiply it with -1, we get the other direction, and if we normalize it, we get like the unit vector, whatever. So that's what we are doing here. And let translation, it will be direction times speed times delta seconds. We get the amount that we want to move in that direction. And now we just have to update the translation of the asteroid. So where can we put here the asteroid movement? Let's see. And yeah, now we need to implement the shooting. Well, yeah, the shooting, just because I don't know how to restart the game on Game Over. Or I mean, we can also have another scene or something where we show the score when you lose. Yeah, that's a good point. How can we like restart? So let's have a score resource. Not here. Derive resource. Let's make it default. Score. It will be just U32, like the number of. Oh, hello, baby. Let's make it asteroids. So let's init the resource. Init resource score. Okay. And yeah, as I said, now we could implement the shooting. So we already know how to get the window position. Let's just copy this thing. Let's just copy this thing. Player, I mean, player shooting. So we need the window query for the mouse position. And we need all the steroids, but just the transform. Just the transform. Okay. We might also need the commands to despawn. So mute commands to despawn the asteroid. Okay. So straight query just iter. Okay, we get the X and the Y position of the mouse. And yeah, now it will be interesting how we detect the collision. Although this thing we could have done before, like here, like there's no point in even for this one we can do it before. Like there's no point in computing it each time. So yeah. So we have the transform of this thing. So we want to get the collision. So how I'm thinking to achieve that is, let's say we have the center, we have a point here, and we have a line, and then we have the circle, right? So I was thinking to get the distance from each center to the line. And if this distance is smaller than the radius, it means that it intersects with the circle. That's how I wanted to do the collision. So let's figure out distance from point to a line. What's the formula? Well, yeah, this looks familiar. Maybe it's, yeah, like this. This is the formula. I mean, to be honest, I don't know how to derive it, but let's just take it. So, yeah, I mean, the thing is that we need the line equation, and I'm not sure how to get it. So let's say we have this thing. I mean, if we have this point and this point, wasn't it like x minus x1 divided by y minus y1, and it was equal to the other thing, like x2 minus x1 or something. So we can put these as zeros. And then we have, so all these will be zero because we start from zero. So it will be like this minus y times x 2 equals 0. So we have A, B, and C. C is 0, right? So we have A and B, which are our little values here. So yeah, let's say here, let A equals basically Y, let B equals minus X. Right, and let's do this thing here. So let D equals this thing. Let's call it D1, and let D2 equals, is it okay, A times A plus and then A squared T, and then let D equals D1 divided by this. All right. And So this gives us the I mean, I'm not sure if it can work like that, so we might also need entity here, entity to this point. So here we get entity and transform. So we can display it like this. Okay, now let's see. We can add player shooting here. Player Whoa. Okay, I mean, oh, it didn't work. No. It shoots from the side. Oh yeah, and it shoots in both directions. That's funny. It shoots from all the sides, what the hell? I mean, it shoots from the side. Okay. I mean, I'm pretty sure I did something stupid. So this multiplies with this, this with this. Yeah, that's what I wasn't expecting it to like shoot in the other direction also. Yeah, whatever. Let's look for the mouse button. At least make it like this. I mean, it's a feature, not a bug, right? It shoots from both directions. Yeah, this is what we are looking for. So if the left button. Can we just return if it's not pressed? At least make it. Yeah, like, see, it shoots from. I don't even know. Yeah, something is not quite right. I mean, it's time for debugging. Like, yeah, let's show the distance when we click. I'm curious to see. Oh my god, it's negative. Yep. Okay, I mean, this makes me. Oh, it was modulo. Yeah, because it was like, what the hell, negative distance? When you know, when you are taking the exam and you get a negative distance and you're like, okay, I fucked up. Okay, but it shoots from the side. That's the more concerning thing. I mean, it's funny though. Oh my god, oh. Got them. Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty sure I did something wrong with this calculation if it shoots from the side. So, like, this is correct because we copy-pasted it. X is multiplied with. I mean, what? Do you want me to do this and be like, okay, now it works? But I'm not sure if that fixes anything. Because it looks like. I don't know, it looks like it's just the wrong direction. Like the direction itself is wrong. Like this should be X and this should be Y, something like that. No. That's what it looks like, to be honest. Yeah. I don't get it. So, yeah, because we get the position of the mouse. X and Y. Yeah. It's really interesting. Maybe this is not the best way to get the intersections, but I was hoping that it might work. Well, the other option is to like force the player to click directly on the thing, but I mean that would be a bit lame. Like it's an aim trainer instead of laser shooting thing. I mean I have to think about it a bit. So let's leave it like this for now, and let's implement the game over maybe. So, per collision. Collision. For this one, we just need the query for the asteroids. Just a transform. Okay. And for this one, yeah, basically, no, why? Like, if I mean, if it touches the center, I wanted to say, like, this is so dumb. Okay, so, if the distance from the center to any of them, So basically, distance from center is like x squared plus y squared, and then sqrt. If d is more than this thing, then we println. Game over for now. Where was our main here? Player collision. So let's leave it. So it can know that it's game over. And yeah, just to maybe showcase the states. Yeah, we also have to. But derive, it was something like state, but I don't remember. Davis state. Something like this. And let's say in game and game over. Just to show it. So let's put it separately at systems, and it will be update per collision, and this is run if in state in game. This, not really. Yeah, you'd think that. Yeah, like this. It's like from an old version, so. Okay, also need to say states. That's what I was thinking because it looks like make this like default. How do you make it default? Okay. Okay, and we also need to insert state, or how do you do it? To be honest, I don't see the main function. Oh, it was above. Yeah, it was init state. I knew it. I was looking at init. Anyway. Oh. But this is like from the main version, what the hell? Something's not right. Maybe it's like a new function. It will be added in like a newer version because I'm looking on the main branch in game. Wait, no, this is like really sus. Now how do you init the state? state. So it should print the game over message only once. Like this. Well, it didn't. Oh, because we didn't really switch the state. So, to switch the state, we need this thing, like next state, and we need to set it to game over, but set dot set, and we change it to we change it like this. So should show it only once, yeah. And maybe the other thing is running these only if we are in game. Like we shouldn't see any more updates. Wait. I mean, yeah. That's fine. Anyway. So, like this. And what if we also have here the score, and we show the score. Here we need the mutable score. Here we would increment the score by one, and now it is more or less complete. We just need to fix the collisions. So let's destroy a few things. And now if it like stops, then it says the score. It doesn't do anything anymore. Okay. So yeah, I was thinking about this. I still have no idea how to do it. So let's see. Like how, because it's like a raycast, right? But we don't have raycasts in Baby by default. Yeah, I guess that's an idea for another video, how to implement raycast. That's might be a good point. So okay, for now let's just do point and click, although I would really like to have a raycast method of doing it, but just for the point of making this not buggy, let's see. So let's say dx is this, dy is that, like the difference between x and y, and then we get a distance. So we compute the distance from the center of the circle or the asteroid to our mouse pointer, and now we need to click on the asteroids to destroy them. So yeah, that was why though? Like, I don't understand. Like, why is it shifted? So let's get the position of the mouse on the screen, and then let's get the X and Y. Screen, and here it's the world position. So that's what I'm not quite sure about. So if we click here, it is close to 0, 0. So yeah, I mean that's pretty much correct. Shooting world at. Those are the correct points. Right, like when it's 0, 0, it should be -400, -300. And when we do this thing, let's print ln the distance. Let's see, because I have no idea why it's why it's doing that. Like, why is it 600? Like, yeah, I mean, if both of them are negative, like if we do minus, it will still get the correct distance. So shooting world at, oh, this is like the distance. Yeah, this really beats me. Yeah, let's spawn something random, like let's spawn something random at X and Y position just to see something there. Because I don't get it. What the hell? There are this. Oh my god. I get it. It's like this is 0, 0 in the top left corner, but our world starts from 0, 0 in the bottom left corner. Like, damn. So that's why the rotation worked, and it didn't work before when I tried it. So actually, for why we need to add, I think. Oh wait. So X and Y are top here, but Y should have been in the bottom. Yeah, right, like if we okay, let's do it for just for this one. Because I'm not sure though. Yeah, no, it doesn't work. Okay. So the thing is, yeah, that this is 0, 0 on the screen. This is the center. If we subtract width from this point, we get it from minus. This is like the minus, and this is the positive. But this is the plus inside the worldview, and this is the minus, this is a negative. Oh, so we might have to do like the other way around, like minus position y. Like flip it. No. If we flip the yeah, I mean now the raycast should have worked, but it's still annoying that it's in both directions. So we need to figure out how to okay, I mean let's go back to when we had the raycast. And let's do here the correct version. And also for player rotation it should be the other way around, right? Like just to make it correct, should be like this. But if we look at how this looks like, it's see it rotates, it doesn't rotate correctly. Right. I mean, if you somehow it looks a bit buggy for some reason. Like to fix this, that's why we need to add that extra pi divided by 2 or something. So I mean let's just keep it yeah, let's just keep the thing like this here with the minus, and if you want to have here also with minus, then we should have to subtract pi from the rotation. It rotates in a sus direction. Yeah, well, I mean, for this one it's pretty simple. We need to just do minus y here. Like, that's why it worked the first time. But, yeah. I mean, maybe spawn more of them, make it a bit harder, but I think this is a pretty decent result for like in a short time, let's say. So, I'll make this into a repository. I mean, it's also pretty short, to be honest. But yeah, to be fair, I'm pretty happy with the results. So maybe something that we need to do is remove this thing. And yeah, let's test again if the score works. I mean, of course, if we had more time, I would like add let's say a score UI. That's also something maybe that we should experiment with, like the UI from Bevy, see how to do it. Yeah, let's see. Okay, so it gives us how many things we destroyed. So this is pretty cool. Now, of course, it would be nice to also have a respawn, but it is what it is. You respawn it by rerunning the game. So, yeah, again, thank you for joining and see you next time.